Welcome back, mineralogy fans. Sulfates, carbonates, and the dominating silicates all take up some of the crust's oxygen, but with oxygen being the most abundant element in the Earth's crust by a long shot, we shouldn't be surprised that many minerals are made by a metal cation bonding with loose oxygen anions. In our mineral overview episode, we mentioned that water ice is a mineral, and now we can say that it is a hydrogen oxide mineral. It has a vitreous luster, a hardness of 1.5, and I honestly don't think I need to go through all the properties of ice, as I bet most of you will have no problem identifying ice. So let's move on to the oxides of iron. With abundant oxygen to react with, we get the mineral hematite, Fe2O3, which can range from a dull, earthy luster to submetallic to metallic luster. It has equally varying crystal form, and its hardness can range from 5 to 6.5 on either side of our glass plate's hardness. But we can be tipped off by its higher than typical specific gravity of 5 to 5.3. The red to silver range, slightly heavier mineral would lead us to try the most diagnostic test for hematite. No matter the outward appearance, hematite always gives a red to reddish-brown streak. The name hematite means a blood mineral, as it always bleeds this red color and streak, and the dull earthy variety has a generally dark red color. Unsurprisingly, it was one of the first pigments ever used by humans for red coloring, going back at least 40,000 years when crushed hematite was painted on cave walls, and is still used to make red to pink paints. Some like the pattern hematite or silver variety in polished form for jewelry, but mainly it is the principal ore of iron in the world. Some varieties of hematite, such as this kidney ore that grew into an empty space and was allowed to take its own form, are a little more valuable as iron ore as they have less impurities that need to be refined out. Due to its relative cheapness and high density, hematite is used for radiation shielding and ship ballast. When powdered hematite is mixed with water, you can get an exact density liquid that can be used to separate coal from its heavier impurities. As a side note, the famous blueberries on Mars turned out to be hematite concretions weathering out of the sandstone, which occurs here on Earth as well. With a little less oxygen in the environment to react with iron, hematite gives way to magnetite, which has the formula Fe3O4, which is relatively richer in iron, poorer in oxygen than the Fe2O3 of hematite. The only reason hematite is the principal ore of iron is that it's more common than magnetite, which is the more valued iron ore due to its higher iron composition. The name comes from the fact that it is magnetic. Be careful here, as hematite can intergrow with magnetite, and a bit of magnetite in hematite will allow hematite to appear to attract a magnet. Use the streak test, as the hematite will show up with its diagnostic red streak, whereas magnetite has a black streak. Magnetite has a black metallic luster and may have some rusted spots on its oxidized surface. The hardness is 5.5 to 6.5, so it should barely scratch glass. As soon as you pick up magnetite, you sense its density. The specific gravity is around 5.2. When working in a field site with magnetite, you have to be careful, as I've watched my compass needle make wild swings in direction when passing a large deposit of magnetite. Conversely, magnetite crystals with a definite north and south magnetic pole, also known as lodestone, can and have been used as compass needles. Even life from bacteria to animals have precipitated their own crystals of magnetite, which line up to make a compass needle or magnetoreceptor in the brains of animals which use it for navigation. Magnetite used to be used in powdered form for magnetic tape recording until it was found that needles of gamma ferric oxide worked better. We still use magnetite to catalyze the synthesis of ammonia, and it is a very efficient arsenic and chromium sorbent to remove these toxins from contaminated waters. The only other iron oxide mineral you're likely to see is goethite, but we want to focus on the most common minerals, or those you might most like to find or may encounter. So moving on from the iron oxide minerals, aluminum is a common cation that can oxidize to form the mineral corundum. Corundum has a vitreous to adamantine luster, which is a glassy mineral with a bright shine to it, and can display a wide variety of colors. This, and its hardness of 9, make it the second most valued gemstone after diamond, the ultimate adamantine luster. In corundum's red form, it makes ruby. And every other color is called sapphire, though that term is most associated with the blue variety of corundum. A specific gravity of 4 makes this a little heavier than the average minerals, but not like our previously encountered iron ores, which were all over 5. Having no cleavage, rubies and sapphires are actually ground and polished into flat faces, unlike a diamond, which is actually cut. Non-gem quality corundum is used as a strong abrasive due to its hardness, and there are some electrical properties of use. But corundum is also one of the most easily synthesized valuable minerals out there, so if it matters to you, be sure to ask about the origin of your rubies and sapphires in the jewelry store. Just to mention some of the more interesting but less common forms, cuprite is a copper oxide. Manganosite is a manganese oxide. Zincite is obviously zinc oxide. Spinel is aluminum titanium oxide. The fluorescent franklinite is a zinc, iron, manganese oxide. Chrysoberyl is beryllium aluminum oxide. And manganite is manganese oxide with hydroxyl. The only other oxide mineral I will mention is rutile, which in large form has a transparent red color and tends to form in a variety of metamorphic and igneous rocks. It is titanium dioxide, and thus can be used as titanium ore, but has a very high refractive index, and so larger crystals are used in optics. You're most likely to find needles of rutile as inclusions in quartz. So, if you ever see any dark needles in quartz crystals, they are almost certainly rutile. And so we've seen all that can happen when oxygen meets metal on this planet, and next we will find out what happens when oxygen combines with sulfur and cations in the next episode, The Sulfates.